I've been with a Java user group for more than 2 years now. So first time when I first attended a Java user group meeting, it was Arun Gupta who was taking up a session on World Fly. So that was the case. That's the first meeting. It was very admiring and it was very much informative to look into stuff which is not yet released or just upcoming stuffs. So today I'm going to take you through a few concepts on functional programming in Java. And last year, 2 years before, when Java came into the market with its new version on March 18, 2014, so people were already talking about functional. The watchword for Java 8 was entirely functional programming. So we will see what is it all about functional programming. But a little bit of caution over here. So there is a change in the climate to change our ways. So there is a lot of change in the market. Okay. So we'll see what is the change in the climate later point of time, after looking into what is this functional is all about. Then you will be able to get why functional programming is required in this change in climate. Okay. So what is lambdas? So this was introduced in Java 8. So it is not for what they can do. They cannot do without you write a programming in a different way. Okay. So it's all about how we write programs. Okay. So it's all about how we write programs. So don't expect that it's kind of a functional feature which will reduce my job. It's not going to happen over here. Okay. So that's the one thing that you need to change the way you write your programs, so that you can leverage a lot from lambdas. Okay, so it enables functional programming. So that is the main aspect of introducing lambda expressions in Java 8, and it adds a new nucleotide in the DNA of Java. Right. So if Java programming was all about structural, reflective, object-oriented, imperative, concurrent, and generic. Now, functional and declarative has got added up into Java. So this is the main core paradigm that has been added to Java. Okay. So here are my inspirations for functional programming. Okay. So why JavaScript, the good parts came in is something like JavaScript was already a functional language, wherein I can take some concepts from there to check whether it is available in Java when it truly came up. So, and then Maria Fusco, who is also an author of Java 8 in Action book. I have a few slides of his, so I wanted to give some credit to him. So, and only with his slides and the content, I was able to grab the core part of functional theory. So otherwise, it would have been very, very tedious to read and take things out. Okay, and Brian Goetz, he has during the time when the lambda was being progressing, and it's a very futile stage. Like he has been documenting the state of lambdas. What is the current state of lambdas? And he used to change what are the things that is going to come up, and what are the things changing. So it was very, very, very much informational for me to start gaining a concept, gain the concept, and trying to understand what is it coming in Java, okay? And functional programming in Java by Venkat had a lot of theories. Lot of simple concepts which anyone can assimilate to get started with Java and lambdas. Okay. So what is it you need to check over here? So we all are in the OOP box as of now. So object-oriented box is something like we would have found patterns how to work with it. We know the constraints of it, and we know how to play with these constraints. Okay. So with these constraints alone, we cannot go with functional programming. Okay. So if you have these constraints, please drop these constraints. in your mind and start a fresh look at functional programming. Otherwise, it is hard to get by. Okay. So, and once we are already in the box, we are supposed to jump out of the box to understand what is functional programming. So, I have constructed my deck, slide deck, in such a way that we are going to go step by step out of this box by making a trampoline jumps. Okay, trampoline will help you to jump a little higher, and once you get the momentum, it will help you to gain higher momentum to jump higher. Okay, so that is how we are going to see what is there in the functional programming now. Okay, so stage one is about understanding the basics required for functional programming. Okay, so what you are going to gain in here is, like, it may be already familiar to you. At the end, you will be on a trampoline ready to jump. So this is what is this first stage that we are trying to do over here. Okay, so let us start. So I understand that it is difficult to jump to another paradigm, which is a different methodology, all at once. So we shall ground ourselves with the required concept, like behavioral parameterization, lazy evaluation, lazy initialization, and little bit of lambdas. Okay, so how many of you have already known about this behavioral parameterization? Okay. Yes, it is exactly as passing around functions as data. We will see how we can change our ways of coding. Okay, it's not like you have to identify which is that something that you can pass as a function. It's not like how you can start thinking in your mind now after functional programming is available in Java. Okay, that's what we are going to look in. Okay, so earlier you might have been working with imperative style of programming in Java, and it all works. Okay, but there is a climate change, so take a note of it. So you can also start your analysis in a different direction. Okay. So here is a simple context. Usually requirements keep changing. It leads to a lot of code changes and maintenance. Okay. So that is what we have been facing all the time. So this is the context. So what we are going to see is a requirement which is going to keep changing little by little, and we are going to adapt it little by little, and that's what we are going to see. Okay, so behavioral parameterization is all about extracting changing behavior out of the context and moving to outside as a function. Okay, we'll see how we can do it. So here is a simple example: filter green apples from a bunch of apples. So I think it's not clear. So let me copy a simple code from already written code. Yeah, I'll make it clear. Okay, where did I? Okay. Can you guys see it now? It's still not clear. How is there any shortcut? Not sure of how to increase this font size. OK, Can we switch out the slides? Okay. It's IntelliJ's.
How do you change the one that's currently in use?
Okay. I think I can go with Notepad++ in that case for some time. It is in presentation mode only. Okay. Okay. Not a problem. Do you know how to increase font size?
This one?
Yeah. Already has tried it out. Otherwise, I can go with Notepad++. Okay. Control Shift A.
Try Control Shift A.
No, it's not.
Do the Eclipse key map?
No. Okay.
Well, no, I was hacking.
Okay. Okay, so here we are. So we are having a simple Pojo class with which is representing an apple with a weight and color. Okay, so this is what we have, and what we are currently is going to do is like we are going to add up some green apples and with some weights, and we are going to add some red apples with some weights. So this is a very simple classic example of representing any lambda expression kind of program. So it's a already available classic example. So I have taken this. So So here, what we are going to apply is a simple filter. This is my okay. So what I am going to apply is a simple filter. So here you can see that the first requirement that I get is something like to filter green apples. Okay. So I get a requirement to just filter green apples out of the bunch of apples that is available in my inventory. So that is the first requirement I get. So after some time, my requirement changes. Okay. So example. So they add one more constraint to show me the requirements. Something like color, weight is also added. Okay. So I again go and change my code to so that what is that color and how to filter it with the weight. Okay, this is what I am trying to achieve over here. Okay, so I write one more method to filter out weights and give the list of apples. Okay, so this is what I am trying. So this is how we have been writing our code so far. Okay, so again one more if I am adding one more filter, say for example I have to combine both both of my weights and filter, I am supposed to take something like I have to write one more method to get that done. Okay, for example here's here is the code for that. Okay, so I am just writing one more method to get both filtered by color and weight. Okay, so I think this one is visible for everyone. Okay, so this is something is keep changing, right? So do we see any patterns over here? So based on which characters the changes happen, right? If you question this, you can say that it is based on color and the weight of the apples. The requirements have been keep changing. So we wanted to extract this character out of this code, and we wanted to represent it in different form. So what we do is something like we have apple predicate. Okay. So apple predicate is having just a test as a method with apple. Okay. So here apple color predicate just test the color of the apple, whatever we wanted to pass. So here it is testing green apples. So just green equal ignore case, just test what is the color of the apple and returns true or false back to it. Okay, and when we have this apple weight predicate, so it is just testing the weight of the apple whether it is greater than 150 or not. Okay, and it is returning just true or false back to the color. Okay, so this is the these are the two predicates. So we have created a strategy saying that a predicate is an interface. We just test apple, and weight predicate is a implementation of it, which it just test whether the apple is greater than a weight of 150 or not. Okay, and here is the color predicate just test whether the apple is green or not, and just going to pass a boolean value to it. And this is what is the color filter doing. Okay, now we are going to change our filter in such a way that it filters in a very nice way by getting the function as a parameter. Okay, now what we are doing is something like we are going to pass apple predicate to test and give me back a bunch of apples which is going to have a color of red or color of green and or it is based on the weights whether it is going to check it or not. Okay, so here we have the apple filter. Now check this out. Where are we? Okay. So now we are passing the Apple predicate. I'll just show you how it is being done. So a little bit cut off the left side. Okay. So I am passing this Apple predicate now, and I am testing it over here. Apple predicate dot test. I'm just giving the Apple based on true or false condition, right? Whether it is meeting the criteria or not meeting the criteria. Okay. So this is what is called as behavioral parameterization. So I have extracted the behavior out of the context and I have put it outside with a strategy pattern so that I am able to pass the function as an argument and I am able to return back some criteria of satisfied criteria of Apple's back. Okay. So this is something that you have learned. So this is the first concept we have learned. So what is next? Can you guys remember? Lazy initialization, right? So next is something on the lazy initialization stuff. And lazy evaluation. Okay. So before that, we can see a little bit of okay. So here we can see that we can even remove that apples instead of passing an argument as an apple. I am passing that I have generified that type over here to pass oranges or anything on earth. You can just pass the type over here. So you can pass anything over here. So the inventory can contain anything, right? Collection of anything. So again, you can pass a predicate and you can test it all the time. So it is becoming a very, very generic now. So this is what we can achieve with Java 7 to the max. Okay. So this is what we have been doing, and functional programming was possible even before Java 8 came into the being. Okay. So this is the max we are getting it over here. So I replaced the apples with T, type T, so I can pass any collection. Okay, generics. I have applied generics over here. Okay. So next is nothing but lazy evaluation. Okay, we will observe the code a little deeper to see what it is doing. Okay. So you will understand what it is trying to do over here. Okay, it's not visible. So here you see that this predicate test, you have to observe when it is getting evaluated. When you are passing a function, it has not been evaluated yet. Okay. So it is only evaluated inside the for loop. Okay. It is just like an object, it has been passed. It has never been invoked. What is the kind of test it is being never been invoked? And only after getting the parameter input, it is trying to invoke the test method and it is invoking. Okay. So this is what is called as lazy evaluation. Okay. So earlier, if you would have passed the exact argument, say for example color, if you have passed the color as an argument, the color would have been say for example if it is coming from something else, say apple dot get color, and then it is coming to the color parameter, the apple dot get color might have been called earlier, and you would have got the color parameter in your hand before calling this method. Okay. So but it is not happening now, right? So it is being tested only inside this particular method. Okay. So the function itself is not getting executed. You have passed a function which you have not called yet. Okay. And you are calling the function later point of time. This is called as lazy evaluation. Okay. So you have got one more concept over here called as lazy evaluation. So that I will take it up later point of time. What is this? Why we are in requirement of behavioral parameterization as well as lazy initialization and lazy evaluation. But these are the most important concepts that you have to take into your mind and map into your mind so that you will start thinking in this direction. Okay. So here I will tell you like what are the things that is available. So I have a supplier interface which is having just a get method. It is not doing anything else. Okay. And here I have a blue color supplier and a green color supplier. Okay, so it is going to return just green value, and above it is going to return only blue value. Okay, so here simple values like color blue and green enclosed as behaviors. Okay, I'm not enclosing some kind of logic into it. Earlier in the predicate, I was just enclosing a logic like to test green or to test the weight is more than 150. This is what I was testing. So here we do something else. We return a value alone. That's it. Okay. So here I have all class. So it has a color. Okay. Color as a as a state. The state is color over here, and the color supplier is something is a holder of a function, right? It is not actually is going to hold the value. It is going to hold a function over here. Okay. So here I have a wall constructor which is going to take a parameter called as color supplier. Okay. And the color supplier is holding the behavior to supply a value like it is green or blue, right? So here here you can see that the initialization of this dot color happens only when the get color method is called. Instead of being invoked earlier in the constructor, I have delayed its initialization later point of time. Okay, so where it, so this is a kind of a lazy initialization. So instead of having a behavior to do some testing, I used it over here for passing values and initializing the states of the classes later point of time. Okay, so this is lazy initialization. So this is also possible even without lambdas or even in earlier shape of programming where we are doing lot of work. Okay, so why its importance is getting we will come to the point where we will have this importance over later point of time. Okay, so here this can be even applied for state machines. So you can create something like a simple ticket handling system which is going through a lifetime, like a new and then in progress, tested, and it's closed. So it is a kind of state that you are going to go and it is going to get completed. Okay, or your life cycle, like your applet life cycle or your thread life cycle. Also such a kind of system when you are trying to design, this lazy initialization will help a lot. Okay, so what are the points to note over here? So the apple filter, the behavior being passed as a parameter carries an expression just to test whether it is green or weight is of more than 150 or not. Okay, and in the case of wall class, it is carrying a value directly, so to set the state of the object. Okay, so we are done with our basics. Okay, so we are so there is one more step I wanted to put up, because we wanted to introduce lambdas and where they are being applied. Okay, so here if you see the patterns, you are seeing a similar pattern over here, a strategy pattern over here. So apple predicate is having a strategy pattern, and a supplier is having a strategy pattern, and we have some filter expression, and we have a wall class which is going to get initialized lazily. Okay, so here when you want to create a real object for apple predicate, you will either use a new class defined which is implementing this apple predicate, and you will implement it. Okay, let me take it. So you could have done like this, right? Apple predicate implements apple predicate, and you would have done this entire class newly defined. Okay, if it is not the case, what you would have done? Yeah. Over here you can see that I am defining an anonymous class over here for apple predicates. Okay. So here you can see that I have created an anonymous class without any name over here to get this. Okay. So here is the logic over here for that implementation. Right, this is the implementation that I am passing to this filter to get this done. Okay. Now I can go over one more step to replace it with lambdas. Okay. So here you can see that I am using a lambda expressions instead of an anonymous class. Okay. So now I am passing a behavior or a value with an lambda expressions instead of passing it with the class or an anonymous class. Okay, that is the change that we can easily adopt now. So there has been a lot of changes that has happened right from the JVM to the JRE and the JDK to make this possible and to make sure that the performance is increased. And the way we invoke earlier we did not had a dynamic evaluation in the JVM, so all were static, and now we can create dynamically the class and we can load it. And you would have also heard about JJTS, your JavaScript compiler in our Java ecosystem. So just like a dynamic invoke that we have to do. So dynamic invoke is possible. So lambda expressions are going to get dynamically invoked instead of loading a class anonymously and then being worked out over here. Okay, the speed will be higher over here. Mm-hmm. Okay. So this is what is being taken care by the JVM instead of we taking care, there is a lot of changes that has happened in JVM level to ensure that the class it should not increase the class bloating, right? So a lot of when we should not get the Premjan issues over here when we are loading a lot of classes like this, when we are taking up lambda expressions and to load a lot of classes. Okay, they are being taken care of, and it is easy to modify this code when we are presenting in terms of lambdas. Okay, we'll see how it is being done and what are the other concepts that is coming behind this scene. Okay, so here is this anonymous class and lambda expressions that we have already seen in the code itself. Okay. So stage one is completed. So we have done with our homework on basic concepts that is required. Okay. Now we are going for stage two. So this is this is something on the functions and it is going to be on mathematical aspects. So we'll see what is a function is all about. Okay, so we have understood the basics. So I hope everyone are clear with the basics to go for stage two. Stage two will be little, it will be a thought provoking, and it will be we are going to go out of box to start thinking in a different way. Okay, we'll see what is stage two. So it may be familiar to you, it may not be familiar to you, and at the end, you may have made jump yet not reached the required height. Okay, so stage two. We are ready for this. Okay, so functions are nothing but possible behaviors, and they are not methods. Okay, and they may be an expression or a value, as said before. Okay, FP is all about these functions, and lambda expressions is concise form of these functions. Okay, so a method can act as a function when it is an expression or a value. Okay, so that is where we have something called as method references. With which I can pass any method as a, instead of lambda expressions, I can go a little bit concise to pass a method as a reference. Okay, take this expression and evaluate it. Okay, that's what it is going to take. Okay, so what is a pure function? Okay, so when you say pure function, it is a mathematical term. Now we are not speaking about the functions in C, or we are not speaking about the methods in Java. We are speaking about something like a function which maps a domain A to domain B. Okay, so domain A has a list of set of values, and domain B has a set of values. I'm mapping this function f of x is going to map the x with something on the y side. Okay, so this is what is a simple function. This is a mathematical concept. So this is what we are trying to achieve with lambdas and behavior passing. So So this is what you are supposed to achieve. And especially in programming, what we do is we do a lot of effort to capture the exceptions. We do a lot of effort to assign values, move values from one part of the memory to the other part of the memory. These are some side effects that we do along with the normal function mapping from domain A to domain B. Okay. What is it? Okay, we'll see what is that. Okay. Referential transparency. So what happens when we start working with functions? Okay. So when we start working with functions, it is easy to exchange it is easy to apply a value instead of another value. Okay. Say for example, z is equal to x plus y. This is what is the expression that is going to that we are going to use. Okay. And f of z is equal to 2z plus 3az. This is what is the actual formula. Now I can always replace z with x plus y to form another equation, right? So it is another expression which is taking x plus y as a parameter, right? So this is kind of equational reasoning we can do with if you are going for a pure functions, okay? So the function is a pure if the expression is referentially transparent, okay? And all its referentially transparent is x, right? So this is one function, this is another function. I am making a composition of functions, f of g of x, right? So that is what I am trying to make over here, right? So why we want to write some referential transparent code, that's what we are going to see. So for a developer perspective, it is very easy to substitute, and it is very easy to reason it with the business levels, okay? And in the case of performance point of view, it is easy to manipulate JVM parameters to JVM itself, JVM code that you are going to pass as an argument, and they can easily tune this, okay, rather than directly passing a class or something like that. Okay, these expressions are very pure, they don't have any side effects, okay, so that is the reason they can easily tune over here, okay. So what are the side effects? So reassigning a variable, modifying a data structure in place, setting a field on an object, throwing an exception, printing the console, these are the side effects that we are that we can avoid, and there are some side effects which we can defer. Okay, so functional programming is a restriction on how we write programs, not on what they can do. Okay, so what we are supposed to do, we cannot write a pure functional programming which is not going to be of any use. So we want to defer this particular side effects outside this core, and we have to make the core to be without any side effects. Okay, so here we complete with our some of our knowledge on functions. Okay, so we have completed our stage 2. So how much is left? Done. Okay, so back to programming. We'll see a little bit of programming over here, and we are going to see one more concept called as partial application. Okay, so with this almost we will be able to complete a little bit of our session. Okay, so back to earth. At the end you are ready for another jump to reach more height with more momentum. Okay, so a simple converter utility. So I think it is not. Okay, so you can see this. So it's a very simple utility, right? So it's taking an amount, factor, and a base. It is just doing a multiplication and an addition, right? So for Celsius to Fahrenheit, you just pass the argument and you get a converter, you get the converted value, okay? And for dollar to pounds, you can easily do it. And kilometers to miles, you can easily do it. A very good utility, okay? So now we are going to see how we can convert it with the functional programming to a little bit extent. Okay, so everything works fine. We observe across conversion, here the base and factor alone need to be changed for creating different conversion behaviors. Okay, so you can see that the base is something changing and the factor is changing to create a different conversion functions or different conversion behaviors. Okay, so we have to create a strategy like this. So a conversion strategy. So for Celsius to Fahrenheit, for dollars to pounds, and kilometers to miles. Okay. So this one, I think it will not be visible for you. So again, convert method is there, which is going to accept the amount parameter and it is going to return value after conversion from Fahrenheit to Celsius, kilometer to miles, and the dollars to pounds. Okay. So here we have a conversion strategy, which is going to have a only one method called as double convert double amount. That's it. Okay. So here you can see that we have partially applied our parameters, base and factor, in their respective strategy. We have created a base behavior parameterization. So you can relate it now to the base concept which is required now. Okay. So consider we are partially passing a part of the expression and then rest of the expression is already applied. Okay. And we are having separate strategies. So from simple utility to strategy. So you can see that we have created classes new, right, to form a function or a behavior which we can always invoke to get the output, right, by applying one more parameter called amount, right. So this is what we are doing, and jump one is with the help of anonymous classes instead of creating a new classes for this case, and the another jump is something like we go for a lambda expression, right. So this is the expression that looks like a math expression, a pure function, right? We are not having any side effects like reassigning variables or nothing like that is available. Okay. So points to note over here is like we achieve modularity, and we apply two parameters to create strategy, and we have a problem over here. We have a lot of anonymous classes or lambda expressions. Now you can get that what we are where we are reaching. Okay. So what is that we are going to do? That's what is the next stage is all about. Okay, so more programming, more abstractions, more modularity. Okay, that's what we are trying to achieve over here. So the jump to reach more height with more momentum. So we're ready for a jump. Okay. Okay, reusing lambdas. So what I am creating is a generic So is this visible? Okay, very good. So here what is that I'm doing is like I'm creating a helper method called as generic converter inside an interface. It is possible now with Java 8 alone. Okay. So factor and base is being provided as parameter, and I'm returning a behavior after applying the factor and base. Okay. So here now what happens is like I have reused this same helper method to create various behaviors. Okay, so that is what I am doing over here. So now lambda expressions has been reused. Okay, this concept is being applied based on this particular scoping called as lexical scoping. Okay, so you are able to take the environmental parameter and apply it to a function to form another function. Okay, so this is what is happening over here. So we have reused this particular thing. So what is, okay, this is good to a certain extent. Okay, so we are going to go for another abstraction, another modularization. Okay, so here I don't think it is visible, so I'll just check it up, I'll just read it out so that you can check out what is this. So we have a apply factor method and we have a apply base method. Okay, so both are returning a strategy. Okay, just it is applying this amount one by one. Actually, these two parameters it is trying to apply it on the amount one by one. So it is taking an amount, it is multiplying it with the factor, and it is returning back the function. And here what is happening is like it is adding a base and returning back that function back to you. So two more helper methods I have added. And there are two more methods. One is for apply, the other is for apply next. Okay. So here I am taking a conversion strategy and I am returning a conversion strategy in both these cases. So they might look little weird, and but they have their own advantages. Okay. So more helper methods like apply factor and apply base, and two we are looking methods. The we are looking methods are functional programming and function composition. We'll see what is that function composition all about. Okay. So here you can see that what I have done over here. Okay. So I have taken the current strategy, applied one value called as factor, and then again I am applying next a conversion strategy to apply the other value. Okay. I am doing value by value. So you can see that we have passed a zero value over here and a zero value over here, which means that no base has to be added actually in that cases. Okay. Now I am forming something like this. Right? So only one factor has to be applied, that's enough. And the other function, only one parameter is applied, that's enough. And it is doing a good job of reducing the number of parameter being passed, and it is being passed one by one. Okay. So we'll have this summed up together. What is lambda of expressions? Expressions for anonymous pure functions. Say for example, square root of sum x square plus y square, and lambda expressions can be something like x comma y be the parameter, x square plus y square is the expression for it. So this is how we write lambda expressions. So if you want to evaluate with say for example 5 comma 6, okay, I can write it like this with the input parameters. Now I am doing a currying operation. This is what is called as currying operation. So we have already applied parameters one by one. Okay. So I take 5, I apply the 5, I get a new expression, and I apply 6 and I get the value. Okay. So this is what is called as partially applied function. So here I am having a partially applied function, and I am getting I am applying one more parameter to get the complete output over here. Okay. So partial application is right. So you guys understood partial applications. Okay. So stage 4 is completed. We have seen a glimpse of functional programming, and we have lot many things to add over here. Okay. Why functional programming might be in your mind now. So we have all these things in place. And give me a couple of 2 minutes, I will complete it. Yeah. Okay. So the big data, multi-core, cloud computing, IoT, all these are in place. So there is a climate change because of all these things. Okay. So lot of progress. So we have been writing assembly language. We have been reused opcode for forgetting about it. Okay. And we have all this memory management taken care, and we have started forgetting about it. So it is taken, actually it is taken care by another group of team. That's what I would say, based on JVM. Okay. So what about parallelism? So this is what we are trying to address over here. We have been writing a lot of code like this in a serial way. And these are the various ways of handling the concurrencies based on threads, semaphores, locks, synchronization. So these are the things that we have been doing a lot of time. So, and then we go for MapReduce kind of stuff, right? We start to break the chunks a lot, and we try to check whether we can evaluate chunks. And then after all the evaluations, I can group other list of chunks and form another MapReduce program. Okay, either we go for an executor framework or a forkline framework, and that's it, right? So with FP, so these are all getting reduced to an easier extent. So we can apply parallelism very easily with FP. Okay, we are not seeing it, what is its capability, but you can go and start investigating about what is this, okay? So what is this reactive manifesto? So there is a lot of change in the background. So we want our applications to be responsive, elastic, resilient, and message driven. Okay. This is what, because in a cloud environment, I cannot have, I wanted to the application to respond to a huge crowd, and the load can be changing all the time. Right. So it should be elastic, and it should be message driven, so that it can be asynchronously solving the huge chunk of data that is coming to it. Okay. And it should not miss even a single data, whichever request comes to it. And it should be resilient. If it is in case of any failure, it should get back faster. Okay. So it should be always, it should never get slowed down. That's what is responsive is meaning by. Okay. We want to even break the applications into different small domains. So that is where micro frameworks are coming in. Okay. So this is what has been changing. Okay. What we are trying to achieve it over here is like, if you map flexibility to complexity, we do not want our flexibility to increase the complexity. We wanted to reduce down that. Whenever we want more and more flexibility, we want to minimize the amount of complexity being increased. Okay. So here there are various ways of developing the applications. One is transaction scripts, where we have a request mapped to a procedure in the SQL, or something like so there is another method called as table module, where we map our Java domain to ORM and then we map it to SQL. Okay, and there is another approach called as domain driven approach. So that is what is a best approach to follow, because of the fact that when you are keep increasing your complexities, you will be able to, so the effort for enhancing it saturates at one level with the help of transaction script and table modules, but it is going in linear fashion in case of domain driven designs. Okay, so functional programming is helping you to make both reactive applications and you want, so domain driven applications plus FP also is a very good choice. They fit in together very easily. Okay, so this is what is happening. So functional programming is necessary for its agility. Okay, so agile way of improving your applications, we require FP. Okay, so OOP versus FP, they are not black and white. You can always mix them together to form any number of states you want. Okay, so multi-paradigm programming is more powerful than single paradigm programming. Okay, so if OOP binds states and behavior, FP decouples states and behavior. Okay, so that's what you get out of FP. So explore more functional programming. Is there any QA? Yes, sure. Okay. Okay. Streams is you still have collection framework, you still have Streams API.
Yeah.
Okay. Streams is something like which is helping you to apply the functional aspects into it. Okay. When you want to, so there are some problem context which is applicable for Streams. There are some problem context which is applicable for collections API. Okay, so it is not always the case that you go for Streams API because it is new and it is available for you. Okay, you cannot take up a pistol. You can always take up a difference between a pistol and a machine gun. They are applicable for their own aspects and their own powerfulness, right? So it is how we have to distinguish between these APIs. It is not always the case that you will be expecting Streams available. Okay, so as already said, please remember, Lambda is not for what it is going to do for you. It is the way you write the program is going to change, or you are supposed to change your way of programming in order to leverage what is available as far as Lambda and FP are concerned. So the climate changes might not have been palpable or tangible for a few of the peoples, but there are a lot of peoples that they are responding to the climate change. You will always see the change happening. Yeah. So that's the reason I wanted you to jump out of the box. Okay. Thank you, guys.